Now we'll come to the other type of market, that is market sharing cartel. So in a typical explicit collusion, one is cartel where it's a centralized cartel maximizing at the joint profit. Then we have market sharing cartel, and here generally the collusion is to share the market, and that is on the basis of the agreement on quota or some other basis, on the geographical basis. In that case, they may charge same price, they may charge different price. So in case of market sharing cartel, if you look at this form of collusion, it is more common in practice because it is more popular. The firm agrees to share the market but keep a considerable degree of freedom concerning the style of their output, their selling activity and other decision. So they share the market, but still they keep some amount of freedom on the basis of their selling activity, how they are styling their output, or maybe some advertisement strategy, they want to keep some freedom about that. So they share the market, but they are also having some freedom when it comes to market their product, whether it's selling, whether it's advertising, or whether it's the presenting style of their output. So market sharing cartel is, again, it's two kind. One is non-price competition agreement, and second is markets sharing on the basis of the quota. So in the typically the first kind, where market sharing cartel, when there is a non-price competition agreement, in this form it's a loose cartel. Generally the member firms agree on a common price at which each of them can sell any quantity demanded. So member agree on a common price, and there is no restriction that what quantity, what they are going to sell in the market. Generally this is known as a loose cartel, because we will see why this is considered as a loose cartel bit later, after looking at the characteristic of a cartel in case of a non-price competition. The price is set by bargaining, low cost firm pressing for a low price, high cost firm pressing for a high price. So the strength of bargaining decide how the price is going to be formulated. So always the low cost firm, they praise for a low price, and high cost firm, they praise for a high price. The agreed price must be such as it allows some profit to all the member. So whatever the price decided by the market, at least it should give some amount of profit to both the high cost firm and the low cost firm. So it has to be agreed commonly by the both the high cost firm and low cost firm, so that only they get some amount of profit. The firms generally, they agree into the fact that they are not going to sell at a price below the cartel price. Whatever the price decided by the cartel, they are not going to sell below any price below the cartel price. However, they are free to vary their style, their product and their selling activity, because they have some amount of freedom over there. So here the firm, they are, even if they are in the collusion, they are competing on a non-price basis. And what is the non-price basis here? Non-price basis is when they are competing with each other on the basis of style of their product, their selling activity. Maybe even if it is a same price, when the output presenting style is different, the consumer may get attracted to maybe the firm 1 or firm 2, where the in particular case they like the product. By keeping their freedom regarding the quality, appearance of the product, as well as the advertising and other selling policy, each firm hopes that it can attain a higher share of market. So even if they are charging the same price, they always feel that since there is a freedom regarding the quality and appearance of the product, their selling activity, and also with respect to the advertisement and selling policy, they always feel that they can attain a higher share of market, they can attract the consumer through all this non-price factor, and they will capture a higher share in the market. So here if you look at, collusion is only on the basis of the price. For rest of the activity, there is no collusion, they can compete with each other on the basis of non-price factors. Then the second case, when the sharing of the market is on the agreement of the quotas. So here it's not non-price competition. Here the market is share on the basis of the agreement on the quota. So sharing of the market on the basis of agreement and quota is agreement on the quantity that each member may sell at a agreed price. So price is decided, there is a cartel price, and what is the, again, what is the collusion here? One is with respect to the price, and second is what quantity each member is going to sell. So here the collusion is with respect to price and also with respect to the market share. So if the firm have identical cost, the monopoly solution will emerge with the market being shared equally among the member firm. How this will become a monopolist? If there is an identical cost, there are 10 firms in the market. 10 firms comes into collusion and they decide two common things. One, what is the price to be followed in the market, and second, what is the total quantity they are going to sell in the market. So if the entire market is divided into 10 segments, and if they are going to continue that in the for a longer period of time, that okay, segment 1 is by firm 1, segment 2 is by firm 2, segment n is by segment n. So that segment 1 become, in the segment 1, firm 1 become a monopolist because there are no competition for segment 1. Segment 10, firm 10 is becomes monopoly because there is no competition, competitive firms entering into the segment 10. So in the long run, generally monopoly solution emerge in case of a sharing of market or agreement on quotas or agreement on the quantity. However, if the costs are different, the quota and share of the market will differ. And this quota is not uniform, or the share of the market is not uniform. Basically, the low cost firm, they will get a higher share, and the high cost firm, they will get a lower share, because low cost firm is attaining the cost efficiency, they can produce a higher amount of the output at a lower cost. So they will always bargain for a highest market share, and they can get the profit through the more market share rather than the increase or decrease in the price, because the price, cartel price, is remain constant and all the firms, they have to follow it. So in this case, when the allocation is done, the allocation of quota or the share on the basis of the cost is again unstable. So if you look at, if it is identical cost, the share is all right if the allocation is share is gone. But if it is not uniform cost, if the cost differential is there, generally this share on the basis of cost is again unstable, because in the time, in the different time period, the possibility is that the cost function of the firms will change. The high cost firm, in a long run, they may become the low cost firm, and if the allocation is on the basis of the cost, it may not suit them, or they may not like to be the part of the cartel. So share in the case of cost differential are decided by bargaining, and the final quota of each firm depends on the level of its cost as well as on its bargaining skill. So when it comes to the final share, what the market should get or what the firm should get individually, that depends upon the bargaining skill. So one is the cost function, second one is that what is the bargaining skill of the firm. If the bargaining skill of the firm is good, they get a higher share, and if the even if they have a good cost function, if the bargaining skill is less, generally they get a lowest market share. So it's, there are two factors here to decide the market share. It's not solely on the basis of the cost function, also it's on the basis of the bargaining power of the firm. The quotas are again decided on the basis of the past level of sales and their productive capacity. So productive capacity is decided on the basis of the cost function and the how cost effectively they are producing, and second is what is their past level of sales. They generally look at the trend of the sales, what they have done in the previous years, because that gives the credibility of the firms to produce and sell in the market. So the when the market share is decided for the different firm, the cost function, how productive that firm, what is their past level of sales, because that gives the credibility of the firm in the previous period, and also what is the bargaining skill of the firm. So on this factor, on this basis of this factor, generally the share of the market is decided. But what is the main problem with this kind of collusion? The main problem with this kind of collusion is that all the firms face the same cost function. Therefore, the sustainability of such cartel is very unstable, because as we are discussing before couple of minutes, that the cost function cannot be identical for all the farms, because all the farms they have entered into the market in the different time period. So some of them they are operating in the short run, some of them they are operating in the long run. Those who are operating in the long run, if you look at, they are almost started to operating as the low cost farm because they have achieved the economies of scale through the scale operation. But those who have entered at a later date, they will always operate at a high cost farm. And also about the productivity of the firm, that decides that what type of cost function they are operating. So when the sharing is on the basis of the cost, it remain unstable, and this cartel cannot be sustained for a longer period of time. Then we'll see, graphical explanation of this market sharing cartel, and then we'll discuss few factor which talks about that what is the requirement or what generally goes wrong if the cartel is not sustainable for a longer period of time. We are assuming a case of duopolist here for graphical explanation in case of market sharing cartel. This is our marginal revenue for the farm A. This is the average revenue of B, and correspondingly we also get the marginal revenue of B. So average revenue A and marginal revenue A is the average revenue and marginal revenue for farm A. Average revenue B and marginal revenue B is the average revenue and marginal revenue for firm B. Then we'll look at the average cost, which is common to both the firm, because we assume the identical cost, and we'll look at the marginal cost function, and we'll identify two points where marginal cost function is intersecting the marginal revenue function. So correspondingly we get two point and also the two level of price. Okay. So we get this is marginal revenue of A. We'll just change the figure, it looks bit clumsy. We'll just start it fresh. So we have average revenue of A, we have marginal revenue of A, then we have average revenue of B, we have marginal revenue of B, we have the average cost, which is common to both marginal revenue and common to both firm A and firm B. Then we have marginal cost, which is again common to firm A and B. We'll now identify two points, one where marginal cost is equal to marginal revenue A, second when marginal cost is equal to marginal revenue of B. Correspondingly we get 1B here price, and we also get one more price that is on the basis of the marginal revenue of A. So this is price A, this is price B. So if you look at here, this is QB, here it is QA. So firm A is producing QA, firm B is producing QB. The total output is equal to QA plus QB. Now same cost function, but if you look at, firm A is producing more than firm B. Why it is producing more as compared to B? Because it has a different cost function, it has a different revenue function as compared to the B. So cost function is same, identical cost function on the basis of their bargaining skill, on the basis of the past level sale, on the basis of their productive capacity, they are producing a higher level of output as compared to the lower level of output. Now, this price, if you look at price, is again to different level. So, this may be the price will come in between, that is PA is the price decided by firm A, PB is the price decided by firm B. But neither PA nor PB can be the cartel price. The cartel price has to be decided on the basis of bargaining power of both QA and QB, and the cartel price is such that at least it will get some amount of profit. So, market sharing cartel is one where it's the share is on the basis of the productive capacity of the firm, the cost function of the firm, and what is the bargaining power of the firm. Then we'll take a numerical to understand this market sharing cartel. This is the demand function. We'll take a separate cost function here, 4QA plus QA square. TCB is 2QB plus QB square. Total revenue should be equal to PQ. So, this is 234 minus 5Q multiplied by Q. So, that comes to 234Q minus 5Q square, and marginal revenue is equal to 234 minus 10Q. Then we'll find out the marginal cost. Marginal cost, ideally it should be equal to marginal cost A plus marginal cost B. So, marginal cost A is marginal cost A is 4 plus 2QA, and marginal cost B is 2 plus 2QB. So, we have marginal revenue, we have marginal cost 1 and marginal cost 2. We can find out the total marginal cost by taking the summation of marginal cost 1 and marginal cost 2. Then we can equalize with MR to find out the output level, to find out the price, and also to find out what is the output level of both the firms. So, if MCA is equal to 4 plus 2QA, then QA can be equal to minus 2 plus half marginal cost of A, QB is equal to minus 1 plus half MCB, and since marginal cost is equal to these two, so this has to be Q plus 3, and equalizing marginal cost equal to the marginal revenue, Q plus 3 is equal to the marginal revenue, which is equal to the 234 minus 10Q, what we have calculated earlier. So, we will get Q is equal to 21 and P is equal to 129. So, Q is equal to 21, MR is equal to 24. Then we will find out the marginal cost of A and marginal cost of B equal to MR. So, 4 plus 2QA is equal to 24, QA is equal to 10. Similarly, for marginal revenue, marginal cost B, we'll find marginal cost B is 2 plus 2QB, which is equal to 24. And QB is equal to 21. So, QA is equal to 10, QB is equal to 21 and Q is equal to AJ whole. Okay, this is QB is equal to 11, because this is 24 minus 2 is 22. So 2QB is equal to 22, QB is equal to 11. So if QB is equal to 11 and QA is equal to 10, then QA plus QB has to be equal to 21. So now if you look at QA is just producing 10 and QB is just producing 11, but still they are in the same cartel, because they are agreed to share their market. And so QA will go on producing 10 till the time the revised output plan is not there from the cartel, and QB is going on producing 11 units. And how they get 10 units or 11 units, this is again on the basis of their cost function, at what cost they are operating, they on the basis of the productive capacity, and also on the basis of their past sales, how much they have sold in the last time period, and also on the main important is the bargaining power of the firm. So if you look at the market sharing cartel is one, where there are two type of market sharing cartel. One is non price competition, and second is market is share on the basis of the agreement on the quota. So in the case of non price competition, they generally compete each other on the basis of non price, because they have the common price is agreed, the cartel price is agreed by all the firms, but they have some freedom with respect to the style of the output, their selling activity, advertisement. So some activity which is non price factors there, they have some freedom regarding that. So generally they will compete on the basis of the non price factor in case of the non price competition, and whatever the price decided on by the market, that has to be same. The second case where there is a market is share on the basis of the quota by different firms, the quota is decided on the basis of the cost function, on the basis of the productive capacity of the firm, on the basis of the bargaining power, on the basis of the typically what is their past level they have, what is the past experience in the selling the product. And on that basis, when the quota is decided, generally it leads to a monopoly kind of situation in the long run, because the same portion is get sold by the or get captured by the similar firm for a longer period of time, and that leads to a monopoly situation in that segment, because it's since this is a common agreement that share is given to typical firm, none of the other firms will enter into the market, even if that firm is getting a supernormal profit or the environment of the market is conducive for the other firms to enter into the market. So in case of collusive oligopoly, we discuss two kind of model. One is cartel, and second one is cartel. And again in the case of cartel, we got two type of cartel. One is centralized cartel and second is the market sharing cartel. Let's discuss that, why the cartel is not considered legal, and why cartel is particularly, if you look at, why it never sustained for a longer period of time. There are some factors that generally contribute to the formation and the sustainability of the cartel. The first factor, the number of firms in the industry. If there are more number of firms in the industry, generally forming a cartel and also the sustainability of the cartel is also questionable, because a small group can work together, a large group working together is difficult, because they operate in the diverse condition when it comes to demand, when it comes to revenue, when it comes to cost, when it comes to their inputs, when it comes to their raw material. So since there is a diverse condition emerged from the large number of firms in the market, when the number of firms more in the market, forming the market and even sustainability of the cartel is also difficult. Then second factor for the responsible for the formation and sustainability of cartel is the nature of the product. If the nature of product is homogeneous, generally the cartel goes for a longer time period. And but if the nature of product is not homogeneous, if it is different from each other, in this case generally again forming the cartel is difficult and also sustaining the cartel is also difficult. Cost structure, if it is in the same range, it is in the uniform range, again formation is easy and the cartel will sustain for a longer period of time. But if the cost function are different and they have to accept a price what is decided by the cartel, generally the cartel goes into the loose end, because the high cost firm, they always feel that the difference between the price and cost of production is getting narrowed down, and they will try to cheat the other firm in the market, and they will try to sell their product at a higher price and with some product differentiation, and that's why the cartel may end. And also it may happen that some low cost firm, they if the price is set on the basis of a higher difference between the cost of production and price, they generally to try to break the cartel price and sell it at a lower price so that they can get a good amount of market share and which will maximize the profit. Then last factor is the characteristic of sales, and characteristic of sales depends on what kind of sales of this product and what is the activity followed and what is the strategy followed that leads to the formation, and also how that will decide what is the sustainability of the cartel. Till now if you look at, there is one only the legalized form of cartel in the world economy, and after that you will find that there is number of tacit collusion, but when it comes to explicit collusion it is not legal. Maybe company they form a cartel, but that is not explicit, rather that is tacit. But the one example till now that is valid in case of explicit collusion is the OPEC, that is organization of petroleum and petroleum producing country. And this cartel is generally the group of people, those who are producing the oil, these are the oil producing country, they form a cartel. They negotiate on the production quotas, typically it is a market sharing cartel, and there is an incentive to deviate from quota and produce more in the form of cartel. It was found that there is an incentive to deviate and quota and produce more, and that leads to the fact that there is overproduction in the market which reduces the price. All the OPEC member has to suffer the low price, and generally the cartel broke over there. So initially the cartel was formed as a market sharing cartel, where all the firms, they will negotiate their quota and they will only produce that much amount of the oil. But in the long run what happened, that there was incentive to deviate from the quota and produce more, and some of the member they followed that, and when the member they followed that, that led to overproduction, and overproduction, whenever there is overproduction, that leads to the mismatch between the supply and demand, that led to the drop in the price, and as a whole all the OPEC member has to suffer the low price. And that is the time the cartel actually broke down. OPEC as a famous cartel, as OPEC, that has broke down. And the punishment for overproduction is, one country typically Saudi Arabia temporarily increase the production and cause the price to drop even more. Even member suffers the lower profit and the original deviator is punished. So in the at the end, maybe the punishment is a different part, at the end the cartel didn't continue, the cartel could not sustain because of the group behavior of the firms, oligopolist firm in the cartel. They didn't trust each other, they were trying to deviate from the quota, they did the overproduction which mismatched the demand supply and reduces the price, in general reduce the profit for all the firms in the market. So we'll stop here today and we'll discuss the other type of collusive model, that is typically the price leadership model, which is by the low cost firm, high cost firm, that is in our next session.